Hello Booktube, it's Brecky from Brecky Writes. This is Brecky Reads, and this is the penultimate 12 Days of Christmas vlog. The 12 Days of Christmas are from December 25th, Christmas Day, until Epiphany, which is January 6th. It is currently January 5th, and we are at the almost final day, the final day eve of the 12 Days of Christmas vlogs. Are you guys happy to see me not vlogging every day, or are you gonna miss me terribly? I hope it's the latter. Today I am bringing you my least favorite books of 2016. I have seen a couple of different videos of people talking about their least favorite books and why, and I decided I too would get into this business of my least favorite books because I have some opinions on things. Some of these are my least favorites partially because they were some of the most disappointing books. I had really high expectations and they weren't met, so that's part of the reason that they are on my least favorites. And some of these are just because they're really bad books. I want to make a caveat to say my opinions are my own. You may love some of these books, but we're all free to have our own opinions, so don't put hate in my comments because we disagree that I might hate a book that you loved. Okay, now we can jump in. All right, I want to go ahead and get my one DNF out of the way, and that is Fallen Kingdoms by Morgan Rhodes. I thought this was terrible. I thought it was terrible on a sentence by sentence level. The writing in this is not good. It's not good, and I could get through 100 pages before I literally gave up, and I was in a buddy read and we all gave up. Three of us, and all three of us are fantasy readers, and we all gave up on this. So clearly this is one of my least favorites. It's just so bad. And I don't understand the fascination on YouTube. All right, the second book on my list is Into the Dim by Janet B. Taylor. This came out in March, and this is sort of a time travel story that many people were calling Outlander for teenagers. And I really enjoyed Outlander, so I thought I was gonna love Into the Dim. I thought, oh, this will be my jam. And they're gonna go to like 12th century England, and it's gonna be great, and I'm gonna love it. Y'all, this was awful. This book was so bad. Not only was it like bad on a sentence level, the characters were inconsistent, there were massive plot holes, it was completely predictable from start to finish. And the more I thought about it, the reason I disliked this so much was because it had so much potential. Like, I could see where this could have been awesome, and it really, really wasn't. And so it pissed me off that it wasn't good. This book needed another editing pass at the very least. I think that this story was just half-baked. The characters weren't fully formed. The main character is completely inconsistent. She's supposed to suffer from claustrophobia and like it doesn't bother her. She's supposed to have a photographic memory where she can recall all kinds of stuff, and you only see that like twice when it should have been flaring and crippling her throughout the story. The other big glaring thing about this is it feels like an adult wrote about how they assume teenagers act and put in a bunch of things they assumed teenagers would like, rather than trying to really get into the minds of the age of the characters. It really felt like someone from the outside was trying to write something to appeal to a group on the inside, rather than trying to just be with the group on the inside. There are some references to Doctor Who in here that felt really forced. It's just that this book just didn't work. It had great elements that went really far astray. The next is a one I read in the beginning of the year, and that is Shadows Cast by Stars by Katherine Knutsson. This is a YA dystopian in which there is a virus that is devastating the world, and the only people who are resistant to the virus are Indigenous. Native Americans in North America, First Peoples in Canada, Aboriginals in Australia. These people have some kind of genetic disposition that makes them immune to this virus, so they're being hunted. Premise sounds awesome. The premise sounds amazing. I am here for this premise. But the actual orchestration of this book is just whacked. It has this weird ending where it sounds like she actually started the beginning of a second book and attached it to the ending of this book. It basically suffers from too many different plot lines. There's like the running away and escaping plot line. There's this whole like crows as creatures that travel between the worlds plotline. There's this whole thing about like the set of twins who are the main characters. One of them is like sort of doesn't belong to the world and has been kidnapped by an evil creature or something and has to be saved. And the other one is like a mysterious medicine woman who's like inheriting all this power, but she doesn't know anything about it. It's like way too much going on. And so it suffers from being completely chaotic. It suffers from having no clear ending, and it suffers from having no clear, direct plot trajectory in which this is moving. It had so much potential. The concept is fantastic. This was such a disappointment. I think it was like a 2-star read for me, and I was so disappointed because I wanted this to be awesome, but It was not good. Okay, then I read Boy Snowbird by Helene Oyeyemi, and I really, really, really wanted to love this. In fact, I have a couple of tabs because the writing was beautiful, and I heard about this from Book Riot, and I heard great things from Book Riot, and I trust Book Riot, and I knew this was gonna stretch me a little bit, but this book is whacked and, like, makes no sense and is, again, trying to do too many things. This is billed as a Snow White retelling, like a very modern Snow White retelling that deals with race in the 1950s. If it didn't have the overlying shoehorned concept of the Snow White fairy tale, I think I would have appreciated this more because there is some good stuff about race and passing, and I think what Snow White fairy tale could have worked, except she doesn't really use the Snow White fairy tale. It is such an overlay that I feel like she wrote the story she wrote and then saw some Snow White themes and then shoehorned the Snow White fairy tale on top of the story. And then there's this weird, like, truth bomb that is dropped like 10 pages before the end that deals with sexuality that has no place in a story like this because it's not dealt with at all. I just was so frustrated because this was a beautifully written book. There are parts of this, again, there's some tabs. The language is just beautiful and it captures you and you're in it. But as far as one, a fairy tale retelling, it's not. And it shouldn't be billed that way, and she does not do justice to the fairy tale of Snow White. And then you have this weird twist thing at the end that is just like, are you fucking kidding me? I was so disappointed because I've heard such stellar reviews of Helene Oyeyemi's writing, and I've heard such stellar reviews of this book, and I think that it suffered from trying to be too much. Not in the sense of the other books that were trying to take on too many plot points, but trying to layer too many elements into what could have been a great story. The next book is in the long list of disappointments, right? That's why we dislike the books we dislike, because they all disappoint us. And that is The Rose and the Beast Fairy Tales Retold. This is by Francesca Leah Block. I'm a huge fan of Francesca Leah Block, and people either really like her or really don't because she has this very strange postmodern stream of consciousness style. If you've ever read the Wheatsy Bat books, which I did in high school, they are their own jam. It's like this weird LA ultra-urban stream of consciousness postmodern storytelling. And I loved it. I actually own all of the Wheatsy Bat books in a bind-up. So I thought, oh, she wrote a collection of short stories that were all fairy tales retold. Of course I'm going to love this. I love fairy tales. I love Francesca Leah Block. You guys, this was so bad. I think they knew that this was bad because look at this. Do you see how much blank page there is? Do you see all that blank, unused space? There was not enough material to create a legitimate book, and so they had to pad it. There were two stories in here that I thought were okay. Everything else was trash. Everything else was stuff I could imagine writing on a napkin after having a couple of cocktails. It was that bad. I'm a fairy tale collector, and I like Francesca Leah Block's style, and this was a disappointment across the board. Her style wasn't very good, it felt trashy, and there was nothing about this that was interesting. It was boring and blah and such a disappointment. Can you guys tell that I'm getting really worked up about this? These books just make me angry because they should have been better, and they're not, and I'm mad about it. All right, this one might be controversial because I know that a couple of you guys have read this and enjoyed it, but The Last Werewolf by Glen Duncan, I strongly disliked because the main character and Glen Duncan as a writer is such a pretentious asshole that, like, it's hard to read this book. I went in wanting to love this book. I love werewolves. Werewolves are my metaphysical jam. Like, that is what I'm here for. I wrote a novel about werewolves. I am here for werewolves. This werewolf is a pretentious asshole. And I get the whole thing about him holding on to language, and part of that is him showcasing the ways in which he is different than a regular werewolf because he's maintained language. I get that concept. I can even suspend some of my dislike for the narrator's pretension with that. But there are so many places where the author has chosen to make unconscionable comparisons that I literally have no time for Glen Duncan as an author. And I will not be reading anything he ever writes because he is a jerk. When you decide that you're going to compare drunk people to autistic people because that's how drunk the drunk people are, that means you're an ableist asshole and I don't have time for you. I don't have time for this kind of cynicism. I don't have time for this kind of pretension. I don't have time for this kind of ableist, male, straight nonsense that is rampant in this book. And I know that some people liked it because the main character is an asshole. I get that. But the author is also an asshole, and like, I can't let that go. I can't. I just don't have time for that. I really hated this book. I really dislike the author strongly because of his continued use of straight, ableist, homophobic and transphobic language that is peppered throughout this. And it's misogynistic. And it's one thing to say that that is a character's prerogative and you are creating an asshole of a character, but it is clear that it is not just the character's prerogative. It is also the author's prerogative. And the final book was an audiobook that made me quite angry. And if you watched My Name is Marina's collaboration video of Least Favorite Books of the Year, you already know what I'm going to say. I'm not gonna spend much time on it, but No Land's Man by Asif Manvi. I dislike this book and the author of the book because it is so freaking misogynistic. I was here for Asif Manvi because I thought he was a funny comic. I enjoyed his stand-up on The Daily Show. I was here to hear about his life. I was excited to hear about his experience as a South Asian Muslim actor breaking into a predominantly white male field. But that story includes the oversexualization of every woman save his mother and sister that he talks about in the entire book. Every single woman, including women he doesn't actually have a conversation with that he sees on trains. I have misogyny in my life every day, and I do not need misogyny in my literature. So that was perhaps tied with The Last Werewolf for my least favorite book of the year. Because they sucked, and I hated them, and they can just sit there in their wrongness and be wrong and get used to it. Okay, and on that West Wing quote, I am going to wrap this up. Comment down below and let me know what your least favorite book of the year was. I think there's a big difference between hating a book because it's just bad and hating or disliking a book because it disappoints you. And there were definitely several on this list that truly disappointed me. I hope you guys are all doing well, and I will see you for the very last Christmas vlog tomorrow. Bye!